Nigeria with 150 million people estimated. That's a very big challenge, and the challenge is malaria. And given the high level of morbidity and mortality, and the country being responsible for 35% of the population of malaria, is very worrisome. This is also because the disease has been clearly linked with poverty. It's actually the driver for poverty, bringing the economy and responsible for health care of the people. The government has responded quite clearly and frontally to the issue of malaria by coming out with a new policy on anti-malaria management of complicated malaria using the acetylcholine foundation therapy as first and second line drugs. But the big challenge is that 80% of the need has not even been covered in the private sector. Therefore, it's not surprising that most Nigerians, especially the poor people, do not obtain appropriate anti-malarials. And in respect to the issue of quality, past studies have indicated the big challenge about anti-malaria quality drugs. A study by Taylor in 2001 and published in The Lancet stated that 43% of anti-malaria sold by drug shops in Nigeria failed to meet the British pharmacopoeia units. But the major market for anti-malaria medicine in Nigeria is actually run by Peter Messing Pendleton Informal Market, which is commonly regarded or referred to sometimes as the hospital for the urban poor and the rural dwellers. In 2010, the study conducted by ACT Watch revealed that 58% of all anti-malarials in Nigeria were actually being dispensed at the private sector, as compared with the 10% in public health facilities, actually giving credence that anti-malaria medicines are largely the market for the private sector. So we conducted this study to assess type, quality, and price of anti-malarials in the PMPC informal health market system. The study is descriptive cross-sectional in design. And we utilize multi-state random sampling to select six urban and six rural local government areas, sometimes referred to as districts, in three states of the Federation that actually reflects major geographic and ethnolinguistic areas in the southeast, in the southwest, and the northwest. Those red bullets actually showed you the selected states in which the study was conducted. We also did the mapping of the Peter Messian vendors, including their shops, and used the observational checklist to actually document stock anti-malarials using various indicators, including brand generic names, unit dose. The NAPDAC number is the Nigeria Agency for Food and Drug Administration agency that is responsible mainly for ensuring that quality medicines are actually available at the community level through the private sector, and also examining the price unit. We conducted some interviews on the anti-malaria supply chain, so we actually used mixed method in the collecting some of the data. So what are some of the findings? One, over 54 different types of anti-malaria were in stock, some of them in adult doses, majority in adult doses, a few of them in pediatric doses. But the average of brands of malaria medicine sold in the shops averaged 5.5 brands. And you can see some of them actually being pictured over there, the portfolio of anti-malaria. Incidentally, when you look at the different types of anti-malaria that are stocked, the artemisinin combination therapy medicine, which actually are the policy accepted anti-malarials for managing uncomplicated malaria at first and second level, is the lowest in terms of stocking. It accounts for about 8.5% of all the anti-malarials, as compared with chloroquine and sulfadoxine pyrimethamine, otherwise known as fancida, which actually have been disapproved by the National Malaria Control Program and NAFDA, based on efficacy studies that are conducted between 2002 and 2003 that show that they are no longer effective. Of concern, actually, is the monotherapy at the suites, which the government has totally banned because of the problem that monotherapy medicines usually give in terms of resistance. So you find out that chloroquine and sulfadoxin and monotherapy were the largest stock anti-malarials by the market. And incidentally, when you look at the issue of price, the ACT is the most costly of all the drugs, costing about $4 at the time we conducted the study, as compared with chloroquine and sulfadoxin pyrimethamine, which accounts for about $0.3 and $0.4 respectively. So it's actually price that actually drives the stocking of anti-malarials in this particular market. And it's also driven by the demands by the public in respect to how much they could actually afford to buy the anti-malarials. Don't forget that the poverty level in Nigeria has increased tremendously. It has not gone to 75%, if I could correctly recall. Irrespective of the fact that the country is the eighth largest oil producing nation in the world, it's quite a shame. And you could see that poverty is actually driving the issue of malaria, as you can see. The table there actually shows us the sources of anti-malaria medicines that we found. Majority of the market movers, especially in the southwest and in the southeast, obtain their anti-malarials from the open market. And the open market is an unregulated market. It's anybody's market. As compared with the manufacturers and distributors, which actually are more regulated. But interestingly, the majority of them are satisfied with the source of the anti-malaria that they purchase. And one interesting thing we also find is that it is from the same open market that even some pharmacists, they do purchase their medicines, although they're supposed to be the regulators of the PMP informal market. In respect to quality, we use two major indicators, the expiry date and the NAFDAC numbers on the packet. Yes, majority or most of them, especially in Kaduna and Oyo State, which is southeast and southwest, have higher proportion of medicines with the valid expiry dates and NAFDAC numbers. The same is not so in Enugu. But even of equal worry is that some of them actually have double NAFDAC numbers, which suggests that yes, there's some aspect of cloning of the numbers on the medicines, actually accentuating the problem of the issue of quality. Reasons why they sell low quality drugs, we ask them, profit and greed. And they mention the issue of the corruption of the regulators, government regulators, that ask for money and so on and so forth, which also creates a problem for them to obtain and sell high quality drugs. But they made some suggestions, and the core areas of suggestion for improving the selling of quality drugs, anti-malarial drugs, relates to the government, the PMP association, as well as the community involvement. So that from itself is talking about the need for actually co-regulation of the market using that tripod. What conclusion can we draw from the study? One is that the PMP informal market destroys large quantities of anti-malarials, but the cost of the nationally recommended ACTs is a barrier to access. There were some concerns about the quality of anti-malarial medicines which are dispensed in the market, suggesting the need for improvement in the supply chain system. And the final one is that the PMP informal health market system needs to be strongly connected. Unless we connect them strongly, it is impossible to increase the stocking and public access to quality anti-malarial drugs. In what ways are we moving forward? There are already startup actions to addressing the challenges of PMP informal anti-malarial market. One is that the government has already started a process of integrating PMEs into malaria control at the community level, backed by low-cost ACTs that are obtained from the Global Fund program. Just like 3 months ago, the FEKS was consulted to actually drive this particular process, and the guidelines are already ready. Fortunately, the Minister of Health, the last Minister of Health, is coming back to the seat, and as soon as he gets in there, I think action should start on the ground. On the other hand, the future health system is romanticizing with the using of technology, especially the quality drug testing equipment for quality assurance, as well as the use of cell phones for messaging and information sharing between government regulators, as well as the PMBs. However, for the last two, we have some financial constraints. I'll be glad to have people who are interested in supporting us in this particular area. Thank you very much.